Thanks. Thank you very much, Dr. Prabhat, for that introduction. I'd just like to say hi to all who are participating. I actually probably haven't had a chance to sort of get introduced individually. From what Dr. Prabhat has just mentioned, there's a good mix of healthcare professionals, particularly from the mental health service area sector. And I thought that, like Dr. Prabhat said, and when we were having our initial discussions about how to proceed with a topic as, sort of broad and as suicide, I thought it might be actually worthwhile sort of breaking it up into a set of series that we would conduct over the next couple of months. That's probably easier to sort of get to digest, voluminous data and information and changes that have occurred in the recent times with regards to suicide and its understanding. Like Dr. Prabhat said, I'm a colleague of his in the Department of Psychiatry, and my core areas of interest are emergency psychiatry and the service for which I've sort of been involved in initiating at NIMHANS, as well as consultation liaison psychiatry. So just to start off with, so the series that I was probably looking to try and focus on, and we'll try and split it over three sessions or probably four sessions, based on everyone's convenience and availability. The first of the series, which is of today, is just the introduction and epidemiology of it. And I'll tell you what the reasons are for why I thought it would be important for us to spend a little bit of time on that. The next part would be about the neurobiological basis and assessment and the progresses that have been made over the last few years in with regards to suicide. And the intervention strategies, I think that's a very, very core area of concern and attention that a lot of people are demonstrating a lot of interest in the recent few years. So, just coming to, I think this, I'm not sure how many of you are aware of this actor, Robin Williams, but he's, one of the most popular actors in Hollywood, and someone who was known for his particularly, comedy-based, focus in movies. And I think this particular movie also sort of probably gives us a little bit of an idea, because this particular movie was about a person who was pretending to be a doctor. If I'm not mistaken, he was actually a medical student who had left midway and then started healing people in the child cancer ward, the pediatric cancer ward, through humor, and used a lot of humor and jocularity and being more of a clown to help a lot of children overcome the distress associated with cancer and its treatment. It was a very famous movie. It was a couple of decades ago, and I was in medical college at that time. But more importantly, this particular slide I thought was relevant because one is it highlights how healing need not per se just occur through medicines, but it involves a whole set of other skills to overcome crises. Also, this what is particularly pertinent is this person spent most of his life entertaining the world, and he ended his life to suicide last year. So it just goes to highlight how even the most famous people, the people who have actually entertained and given so much happiness to so many people, can still suffer from such an issue and end their lives by that. So just a brief background about what does suicide actually mean, and I think it has various connotations. Medical, social, psychological, administrative, legal, spiritual, and religious. Now, these have specific relevance in the context of epidemiology, because a lot of times most of the data and the information that we have comes from one very narrow perspective and doesn't really cover all these areas. Suicide is looked at from a medical perspective quite differently as compared to the legal or the administrative, or even from a social perspective. And what I mean by saying spiritual and religious is, how suicide has been looked at over, time immemorial. It was considered heroic as an honor, as a part of a ritual, both in India and across other parts of the world. Something where people punish themselves for failures, again, part of the cultural mores rather than a particular individual belief around that. And something that had more to do with sin and fear rather than per se mental illness. This was, Sir Thomas Brown, probably in the 1600s, first in his book, which is actually about religion and medicine, actually coined that term. And suicide comes from two components, you murdering oneself and caddies. Despite the fact that in the 1700s itself, philosopher and physician by name of Meridian, identified suicide to be a disease, it still wasn't considered as such for obviously the last few centuries. And it was a psychiatrist who actually identified that there could be unique traits to these individuals who actually end their life by suicide. So what is the current, extent of suicide and what's the current impact? A lot of it is talked about in the media. We keep hearing about agriculture, farmer-based suicides, and I think that's the focus of attention that's been there. But is that the only issue that we're dealing with, or are we dealing with a larger problem? Is there just a selective group that's being, paid attention to? And whether this problem is per se just something that exists in other parts of the world, or is it relevant to India? Let's have a look. So I think, this sort of slide sort of summarizes pretty much the both how frequently suicide occurs in the world, as well as what its impact is on, how frequently it affects people. So pretty much as per the WHO, every 40 seconds, someone's dying by suicide. And so obviously, the sequel to that has implications to the family members, the near and dear ones, colleagues, the society, and overall in the larger perspective, the population itself. So, suicide has been identified to be a huge public health problem. It's probably the top 10 causes of mortality in the world. And 800,000 as per the WHO in the year 2012 was the estimate, but probably more like, 1 million. And like I pointed out, suicide occurs almost every 40 seconds. But what is more concerning is the fact that for each death by suicide, as per the WHO, probably 20 times that number attempt suicide. So we're talking about really, really big numbers. And despite all these, very startling numbers, most of these statistics are probably underestimating the problem. And so it's probably much, much greater than what we're looking at from even the official data that's being generated from fairly reliable sources. So what's the distribution like across the world? If you see the dark red here, which also covers India, these are the rates of suicide the highest. And so it's predominantly, parts of, Eastern Europe, India, and some parts of Africa that are probably the most affected by suicide. And these rates are far, far greater than what is encountered in developed countries. Although it's, most of the majority of the information, the data comes from those parts of the world. What is interesting is the most afflicted and most impacted are actually countries including India. This slide I thought was also very useful to highlight, the differences between high income countries and low income countries and low and middle income countries where India falls. The highlights are to demonstrate the fact that 75% of all suicides occur in low and middle income countries, right? And it's only 20-25% that occur in developed countries. But all the data, all the traditional information about suicide, its risk factors, all is generated from a small, small percentage of patients who are dying by suicide or individuals dying by suicide. Whereas the majority, deaths that are occurring in India and in China, which actually contribute to more than 50% of all suicides in the world in absolute numbers. So what you're talking about is, say, about 1 lakh in a year, or rather 10 lakhs in a year. 7 lakhs are probably from India and China. But the data actually is coming from probably the 1 lakh population or less than that that's affected in developed parts of the country, right? The last one also is very relevant because this is again a very traditional health belief that males are more likely to end their lives to suicide as compared to women. And the rates are as shown as 3.5. So we're talking about 3 or 4 times the number of males are likely to end their lives. And that's what we've traditionally been, taught and trained and come to understand. But what is interesting is the fact that in India and China and other low middle income countries, the rates are actually pretty much the same. So the risk of suicide is pretty much in both genders. It's not restricted just to males. So we need to sort of start changing our perspective about whom we think are the sort of individuals who are more likely to end their lives by suicide, and these would drive a lot of decisions around prevention, management of individuals presenting with a suicide risk. Right. So, what are the traditional things that we're taught about suicide? Well, it's the male gender, like I just pointed out. The older age group is more vulnerable, it's a low socioeconomic group that's actually, you know, more likely to end their lives due to suicide. It's single, separated, and divorced individuals again. And the majority suffer from mental illness and have personality disorders. So is this true for India as well, or is it different? Let's try and find out, right? So as per the National Crime Records Bureau, actually the number of deaths was much, much more higher, right? And what is interesting from the Crime Records Bureau data as well about suicide is the fact that in the last decade itself, there's been a 22% rise in the number of suicides, despite the fact that the population hasn't grown at that rate. So clearly, over and above the growth of the population, the absolute number of suicides is rising. So the rate of suicide is actually rising in our population, right? What is also very concerning and also probably a little bit perplexing is that 40% of all suicides in India are attributable to the four southern states. Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh. This is, you know, sort of confused and perplexed a lot of people because these states are considered the most socioeconomically progressive, both from a perspective of income, education status, and they're wondering as to why this is the case. And this pretty much is the sort of data from a couple of different sources, and which have sort of tried to verify and come to the same conclusion. I'll come back to that later. But looking at the age, again, so the myth was that the older age group was more vulnerable, but the actual fact is that the younger, more productive age group are the majority of victims. And so we found that almost 35% of all suicides are in the 15 to 30 year age group, and between the 30 and the 44 year olds, it's actually another 33%. So cumulatively, almost 70% of all suicides are between the age group of 15 to 40. You know, this population is actually the more productive one, the more likely to, you know, contribute to from a macro level, you know, the economy. And so the implications are really, really big. Also, these rates pretty much concord for both genders. And it's not just for the male gender alone, as is evidenced by this particular slide. So if you look at the slide, unfortunately, I don't have a pointer, but the second bar chart and the third one indicate the two age groups that I was referring to. Again, globally, if you look at the rates, and you know, the traditional data has come from the gray information that we have, that the elderly, and it's only beyond 40 and above that the risk starts to gradually go up. But compared to that, wherein, you know, the majority of suicides are occurring in low and middle income countries, you'll find that the peak is at 20s. So it's that age group from 15 to 40 that we're looking at, particularly 15 to 29, where the highest rates of suicides are occurring. Right? This table sort of also points out how suicide is probably the number two cause, both in men and women, for death in the age group of 15 to 29. So looking from various you know, sources, it's clearly evident that this group is a vulnerable group, and it's almost that it compares to the top cause for death in that age group as well. Now, this was, you know, taken from the Million Deaths study, which sort of looked to replicate some of the data that the WHO has generated. And this was conducted by Professor Vikram Patel, Lakshmi Vijayakumar, and a couple of others in India and overseas. And they had done a sort of a representative study to see whether most of the data from the Crime Records Bureau was reliable. Right. Coming to gender, this slide, again from the, you know, the WHO report on suicide, shows how the ratio of suicides between males and females, but the lower line is actually the one that is from lower and middle income countries, and the higher line is from the higher red line is from from the high income countries or developed countries. It clearly shows why this discrepancy is there. So the 3 to 4 time higher rates in males is probably attributable only to the higher income countries or developed countries, and in the middle income countries, low and middle income countries, where India falls, the gender rate is almost probably comparable at best 1.5 on an average, chances higher amongst men. Right. So suicide and marital status, again the myth being the single, divorced, or separated, but the data from India clearly demonstrates that it's actually the married, both men and women, who seem to end their life by suicide. Right. So you can see the difference between, you know, the single, divorced and separated people and the married people. So the majority of suicide victims in India actually belong to the married group rather than the separated, divorced or single. Right. Now, coming to the education status, the uneducated are at high risk is what is, you know, what we were made to understand when we were undergoing training. But what is evident by more reliable data is that 80% have received some education. So that's either primary, middle, or secondary, higher secondary, right? And if you include all the people who've actually been educated up to some level, it's obviously 60%, like I said, and basic education, what I alluded to, is 60 as well, right? So clearly the people who are more likely to commit suicide, and some of this information also probably gives us hints and clues to why probably the southern states have higher rates as well. Like I had pointed out earlier, you know, about the southern states. So here, if you look at the right side of the pie chart, and you'll find that Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Kerala form the majority who contribute significantly. The yellow pie is just other states. So it's states and union territories. So that's, you know, so compared to that, the other state which has a significant issue with suicide is Maharashtra, which is well, you know, demonstrated and, you know, highlighted in the media as well. But some of the issues with the southern states probably don't come up as frequently, apart from farmers in a particular community. This is from the Million Death Study again, the Professor Vikram Patel's study. And this again demonstrated the same sort of concordance of the southern states having the highest rates of suicide. So again, the dark red is the highest rate. So Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, as well as Maharashtra seem to have the highest rates in their study as well. Right? These were all age and gender matched. So what about methods? Coming to the methods, you know, pesticide self-poisoning accounts for almost 30% of all suicides in the world. And this is purely because most of this is happening in India, China, and low-income countries. So we, as a country and as probably as a region, probably contribute to the greatest burden of suicides to the world. And probably also, so even the various things about methods and common methods, again, firearms, hanging was what we used to be traditionally sort of taught. But what is clearly evident is that poisoning and hanging is more common, as is accounted in India and other parts of the region. So looking at specifically India, these are the sort of rates, and I've highlighted them specifically. So hanging was number one at 37%. Poisoning was 29, close to 30%, and fire and self-immolation being the third most common. So these three are probably the most common methods of suicide in India. And hanging and poisoning being amongst the males, and poisoning and fire self-immolation being common among the women, right? And within the poisoning group itself, you find that, you know, insecticides are probably contribute to half of that. So the other poisons are all the medications and other non-specific poisons. The rates of poisoning actually over the last few years in India, as per the Crime Records Bureau, has actually come down. And there could be a variety of reasons for this, and which are also very pertinent. And I would probably highlight that in the, you know, the component of management, because I think that's where we need to probably discuss some of these issues further. This is again from the Million Death Study and demonstrate the differences between the genders. So hanging and poisoning was, like I pointed out, in men as the commonest. The pie charts, and poisoning and hanging in women, but additionally also have burns which are significant in number. So the risk factor is probably, you know, based on all this information itself, you know, is a paradigm shift, because I think it's very important for us to understand what risk factors are before we can even formulate or conceptualize with interventions or even prevention strategies. So there is probably a likelihood that in the last few decades, the focus has probably been somewhere else. And that's probably one of the reasons as well as to why, you know, in addition to the variety of other causes, that the rates have been probably progressively going up. I think the vulnerable population has not been correctly identified, and we've not worked in a targeted manner towards those. So, you know, especially in India, very relevant, pertinent to India, and probably because of the absolute numbers of how India contributes to global suicide rate, this is probably more relevant to the rest of the world as well. It's actually the younger people. There is no gender bias. It's actually the married individuals and who are more like who are educated and likely to be more socioeconomically progressive are likely to be more vulnerable to suicide. And that, more importantly, the specific methods that are used to commit suicide are probably unique to specific regions and specific parts of the world. And it has a huge relevance in prevention and management strategies purely because a particular single method that it can be applied universally may not be applicable. We may have to identify unique ways in which we can prevent suicide in parts of our country itself, specific to our country, and also specific to other parts of the world. Now, causes. This was what we were taught, and this is what we held on to for a long time. And this is based on all the data that was generated from developed countries. That psychological autopsies demonstrated that 90% of all people who ended their life by suicide had a diagnosable and treatable psychiatric disorder. And so, mental illness was a focus, and prevention and treatment of mental illness was a way forward to manage the problem of suicide. But more recent data, and this is both from various sources, both the Crime Records Bureau as well as WHO data, clearly suggests that illness, which includes mental illness, is only around 20%. Right? And drug abuse is probably classified as only purely drugs. So, given that we're in the CAM center and the core group is CAM, I would like to highlight that the mental illness here that was referred to is predominantly depression and alcohol abuse as a majority. The other psychiatric disorders really didn't account for too much. Right? So the next most common cause was family problems. Now, given that most of this data is from Crime Records Bureau, there a lot of it is quite non-specific but also specific, and there are overlaps between a lot of these components. Right? So family causes, love affairs, bankruptcy, sudden changing in economic status, dowry disputes, poverty, and other causes have various reasons that actually overlap with one another. And the basis is predominantly a lot of interpersonal conflict, interpersonal stress, sudden economic setbacks or financial setbacks, or academic failure that account for the majority of these. So even other studies have shown that probably mental illness at best, and that's majority, like I said, alcohol and depression, contribute to less than 50% of suicides in India. So we're talking about 50 or 60% of suicides occurring to other causes, which including, like I just discussed it earlier. The implications of this are obviously fairly, clear that, the focus cannot be just mental illness and treating mental illness, but we need to address all the other additional factors and which are significant in itself that contribute to suicides. And how we do that as mental health professionals and health professionals in general probably would be very important to look at. So I'll just highlight this again, because this is something that I've been very keen to sort of put forth, that we need to understand that the changes the changes have occurred in our understanding of the risk factors, and that we need to sort of probably shift focus and work towards, working towards a vulnerable group. Right. Clinical risk factors, which I'll probably get to in a little bit more detail in my subsequent discussions or presentations, would be, just to highlight, acute stress and access to means has been one common thread that has been identified apart from mental illness. And what we need, what needs to be done in the coming, and those are the recommendations of the WHO, is looking at reducing rates in a systematic manner, addressing each of these. So suicide, one of the challenges is how the data is collected, how we get all this information. Most of the Crime Records Bureau statistics which are presented are probably underreported. A lot of suicides actually are reported as accidental deaths. They're reported as other causes. And so we need to understand that most of these numbers are also probably underestimated. Additional thing is that most of the research that occurs in suicide, the definitions are probably, loosely used. Deliberate self-harm is often overlaps with suicide with suicide attempts. So the various, terms used for suicide are used interchangeably and often are not very clear as to what is being specifically alluded to, right? So suicide is very clear about the fact that someone is wanting, wishing to end their life and being aware of the same, whereas deliberate self-harm may not be. And so, and some of these factors probably contribute to being poorly understood in the community. A lot of cultural and religious issues, apathy. A lot of people believe it's an individual issue. It's not something that pertains to them. Like I said, misconceptions that are held and myths held both by professionals as well as the lay people, and the legal implications. This also additionally is a huge problem because suicide is considered to be a crime in India. And that's again the reason for why underreporting happens with respect to it. There isn't any formal reporting system in the country, countrywide, citywide, city-specific, or even state-specific. So there is no way of actually gathering all the data in an accurate manner. The resources for such a process or even intervening is, you know, something that is very limited in India. And there are macro issues in terms of policy-based matters that also affect the fact that suicide continues to remain poorly understood. So what is this, what implications does this have really, right? So at an individual level and both at a relationship level, because those two are the things that seem to be primary things that we need to focus on, right? And it's not about relationships and separation, but it's actually about relationship conflict, discord, losses, sudden losses, right? In an individual, obviously previous suicide attempts and mental disorders, but also alcohol use, financial loss, hopelessness, chronic illness and chronic pain, genetic vulnerability to suicide by way of a family history, which is also a modeling component rather than just a pure genetic component. And these are going to influence our mental health policies, how we look at policies to reduce harmful use of alcohol, improving healthcare, restriction to access of means, probably media reporting, which is again a huge thing that plays a part, increasing awareness about mental health, substance use disorders and suicide, and specific interventions for vulnerable groups, identifying these groups and intervening with them, empowering the society in general through gatekeeper training and crisis helplines, and ensuring follow-up and community-based support, assessment and management, as well as assessment and management of both substance use and mental disorders. So I think, this picture is something that I tend to, sort of hold on to. And it's something that we tend to communicate to a lot of our victims as well, is that you need to keep fighting and not look at suicide as a recourse. And that's something that we need to start believing in before we actually start working with this problem. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Dr. Senthil. Dr. Senthil presented a very overview about the myths and concepts of the suicide, its previous thoughts and how things are changing. And also you highlighted that previously most of the data which were from Western data and had a different type of perspective, but now with the better data available from the both developing country and Islamic countries, things are changing. I'll open up a discussion and can definitely head on, and in your practice, I'm pretty sure you must be seeing a lot of patients with suicidal attempt or probably committed suicide. You can give your perspective. It's open to ask any questions also. What is your start? Okay, I think Dr. Bhuvaneswaran, you joined just now. What do you think about Dr. Bhuvaneswaran is a practitioner at Tamil Nadu Medical College.
Sir, here in our setup, we are seeing a lot of deliberate cell phones.
Okay.
Deliberate cell phone, and most are 90% are related to some acute stress. Uh-huh. 5-10% are related to substance use.
Okay.
Under intoxication, they do the cell phone or make a social attempt. So,
I think the point is very right. This is one of the major reason, at least in our country, to
disorders like depression, clinical depression, are very, very rare.
That's a very good observation, and that probably reflects the sort of distribution and sort of patterns of suicide and suicide attempts in our country. And I guess, it would need to probably highlight how we need to change strategies to address suicide rather than pathologize it by saying that it's it's a primarily a mental illness, it's an issue with mental illness, and that we start, once we destigmatize suicide, that's the way forward. So I think most of it, a lot of it has got to do with acute stress, poor coping, poor resilience. And I think we're going to have to start working from the bottom up to address some of those issues within the younger population. And what strategies would be helpful for this, we'll probably take up in the, you know, the coming seminar series.
I think, I mean, just to extend it further, and you know, when you work in the general hospital setting and you've been called by the ICU team to look at a person burn or person with OP poisoning, and first of all, you actually psychological help coordination is provided for very few patients. Second thing, in previously, I remember we used to try to find out a degenerator. I mean, because of what you spoke about, I mean, 90% supposed to degenerate in the West, and I remember that at my time, you know, you somehow put into one degenerator, either at the last adjustment degenerator, which has, you know, how it runs. So it's very important to understand what Dr. Bhuvaneswar is speaking about. See, stress and other circumstances plays a role, and being psychiatrist doesn't mean that you have to only treat a degenerator and nothing else. So that's a very valid point for all of us to have.
Family problem is the one cause of suicide, and it is a large figure. And the family causes gives rise to psychiatric problem, maladjustment problem, depression, and anxiety. And so, why it should not be included in psychiatric problem?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. And Dr. Zulur, is it?
Yeah.
That's a very good question. What has been identified is that a lot, suicide is multifactorial and fairly complex. So it's not just a question of one incident or one factor that triggers suicide or, results in a person ending their life by suicide. It's usually a culmination of various factors. Some of them are genetic, some of them are environmental, and developmental, and as those factors add on, the risk for suicide keeps adding up. With regards to some of these issues wherein you're pointing out in terms of sudden financial loss, academic failure, often the issue is not so much so anxiety and depression, but it's actually a question of the, you know, the pre-existing sort of personality traits and coping mechanisms that the individuals have. So it's, a lot of it has got to do with impulsivity. What has been clearly demonstrated, rather than personality disorders, there are certain traits, particularly aggression, impulsivity, that contribute and are known to be associated with suicide risk, rather than, say, per se, someone with an emotionally unstable personality disorder or an antisocial personality disorder. So a lot of, for example, in India, a lot of the deaths that occur in the younger population, the adolescents, is often in the context of the implications of a sudden setback, whether it's exam failure, whether it's a sudden parental violence that they're witness to, or sudden relocation and loss of home and housing or occupation, rather than it actually having a preceding clear set diagnosable mental illness like depression or anxiety disorders. So that doesn't mean that these people may not have low mood or anxiety symptoms, but they may probably not fulfill the criteria to meet that would be appropriate for making a diagnosis of mental, a psychiatric disorder.
Yeah, in the substance use cases, people with addiction and or substance abuse, definitely the risk or at least voicing the concerns are much higher. I think most of you agree that people do attempt under intoxications, and most of the at least pharmaceutical agents are pretty powerful stuff to kill a person. Something like opioids or heavy benzo, heavy stuff that can kill, and judgment gets impaired very faster. And this is a very vulnerable group where you have death, suicide, and substance go hand by hand. And I think the slide shows that. In India itself, alcoholism is one of the depression. Alcoholism is one of the major causes. But Dilo's question is, what is the relationship between personality and suicide? Is there something strongly coming up?
Yeah, so that's exactly what I just probably mentioned. I wasn't I hadn't seen that query, but there has been no specific personality disorder. Like I said, traits have been identified, and these traits probably make people more vulnerable. And these are all interlinked and interrelated. The issue of impulsivity, aggression, is part of that externalizing component, and that in itself has some genetic basis as well as an environmental and a developmental component. And so a lot of these people are more likely to end up using alcohol, either get into a dependent pattern or an abuse pattern. So when they are actually facing some sort of stress in their environment, in their lives, they're likely to sort of revert to those maladaptive coping strategies, or get heavily intoxicated and then make an attempt which they otherwise probably wouldn't have. So it's about that, additive, factors rather than one individual personality disorder. Traditionally, we were trained and taught that, emotionally unstable personality disorders have high risks of suicide, or cluster B personality disorders have high risks of suicide. But what the literature has demonstrated is that while the rates of suicide are high in this particular cluster or even this particular cluster, the number of deliberate self-harm attempts are probably high. So a lot of times the intention is not to die in this specific group, the emotionally unstable. It's just that it's their way and that strategy of coping with a particular stressful situation, but their intent is most often not to die. And if at all, a lot of the deaths have occurred in that group have probably been accidental.
The same thing, how much self-harm ends with suicide?
Yes. So there are several issues with this. Some are accidental. And that's been attributed to the method used. Often what is clear is that that is one of the things that they've talked about with regards to pesticides. A lot of times people make impulsive attempts with not really an intention to die, but because, like Dr. Prabhat was just pointing out, medications and certain toxic compounds like poison, especially insecticides, can, even though the intent was not there to die, the person ended up dying. And that's, so that's one of the things that they've actually looked at. And that's why an intervention program to restrict means to pesticides, to reduce availability of pesticides, to sort of modify how pesticides are available to the community, have been put in place. And these have actually been demonstrated to be very, very effective in reducing rates of suicide. There was a particular study done by Dr. Lakshmi Vijayakumar in Tamil Nadu itself, and where they looked at two villages, and they got all the villagers to start putting all their pesticides that they used to take to the farms in a common room that was built and locked up. And every morning, all the people who had their pesticides had to come in and actually take them out and go to their farm, do their work, and return it. So everybody's dispensing of the pesticides was recorded. And if someone didn't return it that day, the people knew whom the pesticide was with. Right? And automatically someone didn't return from their farm, they knew who the person was. They could identify. And so they found that over a 12-month study, they found that the rates of suicide by pesticide actually went down in that particular village where this method had been put. So it was a very simple method. It just involved a little bit of organization and structure and thinking about using an approach that is locally applicable and relevant.
There is extent to kerosene. I remember the discussion happening that kerosene burn is one of the major cause of some part of the country. Probably restriction of kerosene, you can have something that replace kerosene also. It's not kerosene must for food. Probably the other strategies can be definitely small strategies can have a lot of impact. And our residents are keeping quiet. And anything you want to ask,
Sir, I have three reflections in the presentation. Like, if you look at the suicide rates and the causes, there's a changing trend. In the past, the trends are different. And now, the trends are actually different. So, maybe, we can say myth or fact. So, past trend and the present trends are changing. Now, what is the take-home message, the way forward? Maybe in the past, in a decade ago, if you look at in southern state, Kerala was having highest suicide rate. But it has come down drastically if you look at the percentage in the current trend. So what are the things that went inside the state? What are the things? If you look at the mental health professionals, Kerala has a lot of mental health professionals. A lot of input actually went into the state. So whether that is anything has changed in the preventing that, if you look at the other state. And then the other state, we are now having the rise of suicidal thing in there. So that is something to see that we know what has gone in the state. So that is the one thing. Now, the race, now we have seen that causes and the risks, whether those are the things which are predicted or associated. Because the fact is different, the risks are different, I think. I don't know how it has been derived, whether the facts we can say as in risk. For example, like one example I can say, married people are now having higher rate of suicide. Marital status is the risk or marriage itself a risk?
Yeah.
So that is the way I look at the thing in that, maybe. So
then, some of your observations do highlight some of the dilemmas, but it's not a question of it was the issue was, how do we sort of identify a vulnerable group in the community? So who are the people? Suppose a person does express that they wish to die. How do we know that this person is likely to do it in the near future or distant future? Or how do we know that this person is less likely to do it? It was about prediction. And so that's wherein risk factors came up. Causes is very different. Causes was wherein this was more through a process of psychological autopsies, wherein the attribution for the reason for why that person committed suicide, that particular individual committed suicide, was attributed to a certain thing. So the issue with causes that I have presented is what has been reported by the family, stating that he, or documented in the records that has been submitted to the Crime Records Bureau, saying that mental illness. So that's why I said that, also particularly said that a significant portion of it is other causes. It's not being, nobody has written anything. Why that person, people have left suicide notes and stated that, this is the reason I'm dying. So those are the sort of sources for why a particular individual has committed suicide. Whereas risk factors are a vulnerable group or identifying people who might be more vulnerable or likely. We had a very traditional model which was probably based on, it was not about changing trends, but actually based on the information, sort of bias that we have actually had. Most of the information that was, through which we receive our training has been generated in the West, in developed countries, which are probably not pertinent to our society, but pertinent to our community. And that's why the more recent data, which is now coming up in a more systematic manner from India, is probably having greater relevance. And it applies to what, we're faced with and encounter with on a day-to-day basis.
Another thing is the cause, family problems are most common, 25%. If you look at those things, actually, it's not about the family problem. The families are changing. If you look at the family composition, family structure, there are a lot of differences in the past and present. Single man family or like four members in the family are different in four places. Like these are the kind of composition, change, transition. There are a lot of transition occurring in the current families. So that is a major cause of this suicide. It is highlighted in the presentation also. Yes. And that we should look it up and reflect on other things also. Yeah.
Okay, I think a couple of minutes left. Okay. Yeah, I think Dr. Bhuvaneswaran, I think you can unmute and speak. You have a very interesting point.
Actually, we are seeing around 5 to 10 cases of parasuicide per day, sir, as two psychiatrists we are seeing. And we hardly have only 20 minutes for the patient. Within that 20 to 30 minutes, we have to teach them about how to improve coping skills, how to do problem solving, or how to reduce the deliberate self-harm, how to control the substance abuse if they have. So these things we have to do within 30 minutes. Whether any small training can be available or any demonstration, how to do this in a short time can be available in future sessions.
I think first of all, at least in your hospital, your other colleagues are sensitive enough to send the patient to you for the intervention for the mental health. It itself is a great thing, because my experience with most of the general hospitals is that sometimes, because suicide patients will end up in medicine or ICU or other anesthetists, so it hardly comes to you. It's a very good, at least they're identifying. Yeah.
In our hospital, before discharge of every suicidal attempt patient, they get a psychiatric opinion, sir. That is the protocol of the hospital. We discussed with the HOD of medicine and we have made it possible, sir.
Very good. And I think your first suggestion is very important. I'll probably sometime next month or next slot, we'll definitely have a small session with a group of expert work in this area. It probably how in a busy schedule of 15 to 20 minutes to have assess the person and at least give some coping skills, some sort of how to handle things. And probably, I think it's a very relevant point that this session is that can you have a small session on topic with demonstration, how to improve coping skills, problem solving, and sort form of debate if possible. I think we'll definitely take it up, Dr. Bhavendran. I urge you that with your leadership, having seeing so many patients, definitely liaison with Dr. Senthil's team will help you to develop a set up there itself, which is a long-term aim that people come to your hospital, get the best treatment from our assistance or help. I will connect you to Senthil. You can have a connection offline and I will do it. Thanks a lot.
Thanks,
Bhavendran Bhavendran. So nice of you. Now, I thought let's have a quiz. 5 minutes left. Last 10%, including all of you sitting here. So if you remember last 10 patients, how many percent you thought had a suicidal thought or suicidal thought or attempt or history of attempt or had a suicidal thoughts or ideas, let's see, ideas or attempts? Last 10%. Anybody can guess?
Maybe in cases.
No. In our practice, I can. Yesterday OPD, last 3% I saw, all are suicidal. 1% was, I think our residents are here, they've got cases. 1% homeless person, female, husband has actually left her because of a middle class lady, left her. And this lady has actually gone thrice and jumped in front of the train. By God's grace, she's still alive and here. I mean, I have to admit with a lot of, so without attendant, I have admitted as a different issue. So, this. And in second case, I don't know who saw the second case, who are, probably you saw, I think, the homeless guy.
Again, alcohol dependence had come alone to the OPD, no family support, had two children, and had actually planned to kill his and his family's life.
One case, post-stroke depression and then suicide. Another case, alcohol-induced psychotic disorder, secondary to psychosis, suicide.
So, I mean, variety pictures. So, there is a homelessness, there is a deprivation, there is a poverty, there is acute stress like husband living away. So, and all the other things. So, it's so common to see. I mean, you know, I think it's like, I strongly feel that unless you, if you're a person who looks absolutely fine, unless you, in your assessment part, include the factors and what the people are vulnerable, yes, they need to definitely ask them. Dr. Saranya,
what do you better add?
Yes, ma'am.
To the list, you better add dowry death and dowry harassment and mother-in-law, daughter-in-law problem also. Please don't forget it. It's a very common cause.
Yes, no doubt.
Daily, I see 2-3 patients.
Okay, ma'am. I mean, I thought of asking one thing to you because you have seen, you know, psychiatry longitudinally for quite some time. What is your, experience of, let's say, suicide patients in 80s or 90s versus now in 2014? Is there any change?
See, there is not much change as such, but only the methods have changed a little bit from, the stove bursting and all the things. Nowadays, people go in very easily for a pesticide or for hanging or a hanging threat and such things. Methods have changed. And, the coping capacities, almost the same right through the day. One, they don't have anything. They are not exposed to any failure. They are not prepared for a failure in anything, whether it is exam or marriage or results or in career or in managing the in-laws or family. They are just not prepared to take a failure and they have never been exposed to failure. That has been of late more reason. Previously, an exam failure was a real failure where his whole future was doomed. Nowadays, it is not a real failure at all. It's an imaginary failure and for that, he thinks it is a very big failure. That kind of coping capacity has gone down so almost zero now. Nobody is exposed to any kind of how to face a failure.
Thanks, ma'am. Saurabh, do you want to have a few words before you wrap up? Saurabh Adibya. And Saurabh is a psychiatrist at Allahabad Medical College and has been, he and his colleague both work in adult and child psychiatry. I don't know if Mike is on or not. Okay, I think. And Mr. Ram, you are an education counselor, so you must be facing a lot of
yeah Good afternoon, sir. Nice presentation, sir, and with very informative presentation. And sir rightly said that risk factors are different and cause is different. I truly agree that, because these days, I mean, mainly I used to see children. So mainly, as madam said rightly, their coping skills are very down now, very less now, because I mean there is so many factors. But here we are using as a life skills as a path to, you know, to improve the coping skills, maybe whatever it may be, maybe emotional or. And what I observe is mainly in these teenage children, previously they have fights with friends, you know, I mean face to face. Now they have technology making them making very, I mean, like I have seen yesterday, I had a talk with one child. One of his friends had sent a message in WhatsApp. It's a WhatsApp group mentioning that something badly on him. So they fighted each other. Actually, there is now technology changed the mainly this. I mean, what I want to say is actually technology making more complicated our psychological coping mechanism. So I think we need to. Last time we had a version. I mean, we had an introduction internet addiction like that. How to manage teenage children with rightly using internet also is one of the part. I think presently in life skills we don't have that such type of things, but we are trying to plan to incorporate those type of things, sir. Thank you. Thanks all.
I think it's a very great idea. At least can use technology to helps people out, which will help them and make them better coping skills. Okay, I think let's wrap it up. If there are no other questions, I'll wrap it up here. Thanks to all.